prospect of a possible future. This event is created through collaboratively with my colleague Carrie Nakamura to try and help us to think through in speculative ways, in a conversation,
how might we think of refusal as part of the archive? Where might we find those modes of refusal in the colonial archive?
An archive which the Research Center for Material Culture is busy with continually in the present. We are all aware that across the Netherlands, but across Europe today, there are conversations about
what to do with the remains of the afterlives of, or the continued tentacles of the colonial in the present, and how these map not only in archives themselves, but on the bodies, the lives of those that colonialism made precarious. When we were trying to think about this project, it also emerged with me trying to think about the question of hope and asking whether or not it was even possible to utter such words anymore. What is it can we be hopeful for? And I had an email in my mailbox that I wanted to send to a scholar for a long time to invite them to participate in a conversation about hope. And it took me 3.5 months to finish that email because I couldn't press the send button. I felt that they would look at me with some kind of strangeness to ask, how even could you utter that word in this moment? Yet, we still continued and pushed ahead with trying to think these two concepts together, mindful of the work that we are trying to do, to see if the archives themselves of those peoples who colonialism tried to foreclose the very possibility of a future had a certain hope or could structure that. And I must admit that I used to sing some long time ago. I was a singer. Want me to start singing? I used to sing. And very often I still do that when I present, and I start out one of my favorite songs these days as I hear the discussions about colonial presence and future. I always go back to Burning Spear. Everyone is talking about peace. No one is talking about justice. But in my older singing life, there was a song that animated my own interest, and it's a song
my mother was close to, and it was a song what
we in Jamaica at the time would call Negro spirituals. That's what they were called. And it said, soon I will be done with the troubles of the world, going home to live with God. That song admitted the very foreclosure that colonialism placed on us. But it had something hopeful. And it is with that in mind that we wanted to invite three scholars here to think with us, to think about that archive of refusal, especially in a moment when the writing of colonial histories in institutions like ours is often, there's often a pushback which says, but it was okay at the time. We're interested to ask, for whom? So, we've invited three speakers to think with us about this, and I'll just read a little bit from their bios just to introduce you to them. Then what we will have is them presenting short presentations, 10 to 15 minutes, to provoke us to think around the colonial archives and what might we do with them in the present. And thereafter, we open for a discussion. And that's what we want. We want a conversation, a discussion. I want to also, before I move on, thank Gina Campt, who is the partner in crime. And I use that word crime very seriously here. The partner in crime in curating this event. And Gina will be with us again to continue these conversations, and I hope to invite Alex and Saidiya as well, this conversation, particularly around the photographic archives, but others. First, we'll have Tina Campt, Ms. Claire Tau, and Anne Whitney, Olin Professor of African and Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Barnard College. Her work includes other Germans, Black Germans, and the politics of race, gender, and memory in the Third Reich. Image Matters, which was a book through which I was first introduced to Tina's work, and for which she came to the Netherlands to look into her archives some 4 years ago. Yay, I'm getting old. You, not me. And her most recent book, which I have been trying to quote every time I possibly can, Listening to Images, which offers a theorization of the everyday practices of refusal and fugitivity enacted in the frequently overlooked genre of Black vernacular photography. We will follow with Saidiya Hartman, who is professor of English and comparative literature at Columbia University. She is the author of Scenes of Subjection, Terror, Slavery, and Self-Making in 19th Century America, and Lose Your Mother, A Journey Along the Atlantic Slave Trade. She has published variously around, and which include The Terrible Beauty of the Slum.
Is that right?
Yes. Venus in Two Acts, which I heard Saidiya read from in another occasion, which was wonderful, and The Belly of the World. And at the end, and they say always last but not least, Alexander Weheliye, a professor of African American Studies at Northwestern University, where he teaches Black literature and culture, critical theory, social technologies, and popular culture. He's author of Phonographies, Groups in Sonic Afro-Modernity, and the book with which I was introduced to his work, Habeas Viscus, Racializing Assemblages, Biopolitics, and Black Feminist Theory of the Human. Please help me welcome Tina Campt.
Thank you, partner in crime. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to have partners in crime. And if you know me, you know that I have a lot of them. I am going to do two things. First, I need to make one correction, which is that we switched up the order. So it's going to be me speaking first, and then Alex, and then Saidiya. And I'm going to do two things. I'm going to contextualize my comments on refusal in relationship to a collective that the three of us are members of, and there's actually a fourth member of our collective in this room. And I'm doing that because we just came from an incredibly stimulating convening over the last 2 days this week in Paris. And I'm deeply inspired by that, and that's where, and I will say that in my remarks, where a lot of my thinking has come from. And then I want to reflect on the framework of refusal as I'm seeing it being enacted in by contemporary artists in ways that I find truly extraordinary, and where I see us learning an enormous amount about what kinds of interventions and what kind of work we have to do in this particular moment. Okay, so I have to turn this on, they said. Turn it on. Then I don't know what to do. Oh, she said it's on. Okay, all right. So let me just bring this together. Okay. How do we write, think, perform, practice? Whoops, that's wrong. Go back. This was your black permit. All right, let's start all over again. How do we write, think, perform, practice, visualize, engage, theorize, story, or enact a practice of refusal? In a multitude of ways, I've spent the last 10 years thinking, writing, teaching, and debating different versions of this ensemble of questions. It's an ensemble in which the litany of verbs it assembles jockey and vie with one another for attention. It is a shifting relation where each term takes its turn at occupying the foreground of our focus and attention, while sustaining a dialogue with those in the background to improvise a multitude of provisional rejoinders to the question at the heart of this query: what constitutes a practice of refusal? My thoughts on refusal have most recently been profoundly reshaped by an extended conversation with the Practicing Refusal Collective, a group formed in 2015 by myself and my friend and collaborator Saidiya Hartman, which has just hosted its first transnational convening this week. The practice of refusal, invoked in the collective's title, signals a rejection of the status quo as livable. It is refusal to recognize a social order that renders you fundamentally illegible and unintelligible. It is refusal to embrace the terms of diminished subjecthood with which one is presented, and to use negation as a generative and creative source of disorderly power to embrace the possibility of living otherwise. The practice of refusal is a striving to create possibility in the face of negation. Our collective came together out of a sense of urgency and in response to the unbearable and increasingly more frequent attacks on Black people in our own communities and in diaspora. We came together through a desire to address the spiraling incidents of anti-Black violence we were confronting across the US and in Black communities to which each of us are intimately connected across North America, South America, the Caribbean, Europe, and Africa. And we came together with a feminist commitment to refuse the precarious state in which so many Black communities find themselves, and the ways in which state regimes across the globe are treating Black populations as disposable and expendable Black bodies, a state of duress we call Black fungibility. Our investment in the concept of refusal was born out of a fierce commitment to Black feminist study, a practice of study that references Fred Moten and Stephanie Harney's inspired articulation of Black study as a catalyzing injunction to create alternative spaces for Black radical thought. In dialogue with, yet extending this important intervention, the founding imperative of the Practicing Refusal Collective rests on a broader recognition of the fact that Black feminists have been studying for a very long time. Black feminists have been studying in coffee houses, in bars, and in living rooms. We've been studying in fields and in workhouses, attics and cellars, by candlelight and in blistering sunlight. We've been studying furtively and flagrantly, in isolation and together with sisters, daughters, mothers, and friends. We've studied the hieroglyphics of the flesh, the erotics of power, the politics of dissemblance, the power of the blues, the possibilities of the plenum, the poetics of waywardness and living in the wake. We were schooled in the practice of Black feminist study by Angela Davis and Pat Parker, Sheen Jordan and Indazaki Shange, Audre Lorde and Bell Hooks, Sylvia Winter and Octavia Butler, Hazel Carby and Hortense Spillers, Maurice Condé and Mabetsi Philip, Anna Seal and Barbara Christian, and by Claudia Tate, Ella Baker, Ida B. Wells, and Sojourner Truth. While our contemporary moment of Black radical thought embraces the renewed urgency of study, the Practicing Refusal Collective seeks to historicize Black study in relationship to the Black thinkers or Black feminist thinkers who often disappear from its script. Our discussions aim to recenter the micro-labors of Black struggle and the everyday practices of refusal that are easily dismissed or taken for granted as complacent, irrelevant, or ineffectual. Our investment in Black refusal rests on a common bond shared by the members of our group, an abiding commitment to the complex labor of Black precarity. I want to use the remainder of my brief time here at the podium by exploring the implications of the practice of refusal by way of the forms of labor produced by visual enactments of Black precarity. The labor of Black precarity, or to parse this term more closely, the work required to cultivate, maintain, or articulate our relationship to Black precarity, is the effort required to position oneself in proximity to, or in a place of discomfort, and for some potential complicity with Black precarity. I want to argue that contemporary Black visual artists are engaging and recreating the visual archive of Black precarity in new and transformative ways. They're exercising a particular kind of curatorial care of what, on first sight, appears to be a troubling and painful collection of images. It's an archive of images that our fellow collective member, Christina Sharp, identifies as the orthography of the wake. It is an archive, she argues, we encounter, quote, by way of the rapid, deliberate, repetitive, and wide circulation on television and social media of Black social, material, and psychic death. End quote. Engaging this archive requires a different kind of artistic and archival practice, a practice that refuses to look away and chooses instead to look differently. Black visual artists are choosing to look after, care for, and reclaim this archive in ways that make us work through and toward what it means to embrace the labor required to engage the precarity of Black life in the ongoing afterlife of slavery. Now, it hits you as soon as you enter the room, a wall of sound emanating from a massive projector at the center of the room. Its sizable scale dominates and intimidates visitors in the dark, cavernous space. Despite its imposing physical presence, its fullest impact is aural and sonic. While the film itself is silent, its visuality is permeated by sound as the rhythmic monotone of the projector suffuses the gallery with a rapid mechanical clacking. Its aggressive and insistent drone is purposeful. It is a sound that amplifies the silence of the image it projects and simultaneously engulfs. The image on the screen is a young Black woman with long braids resting on shoulders clad in white by a t-shirt. Just below her cropped sleeve, her arm provides the only hint of identification through the tattoo it reveals, Philando. The grainy black and white composition of her celluloid figuration gives heightened definition to the sheen of her face, the texture of her skin, and the taut weave of her plaits. Her movements are minimal as her initial photographic stillness transforms slowly into subtle, gentle, and affecting motion. Chin held high, looking upward, chin bowed with eyes cast downward, glasses skimming abundant eyelashes. Oversized glasses reveal soulful eyes. A wistful smile shifts to a mournful look. She mouths silent words, blinking regularly, ebbing side to side, adjusting in her seat, nodding occasionally, followed by an effortful, exhausted in and exhale, a prayer, a meditation, or an internal monologue made manifest. Autoportrait, made in 2017 by Luke Willis Thompson, is a silent portrait of Diamond Reynolds, whose live Facebook broadcast of the murder of her partner, Philando Castile, by Officer Geronimo Yanez in Falcon Heights, Minnesota, offered a chilling account of one of the same endless series of brutal killings of innocent Black men and women at the hands of U.S. law enforcement. comprised of two four-minute takes of Reynolds filmed in April 2017 in Minnesota and shot in 35mm Kodak Double X black and white film, Autoportrait is irreproducible without consent, as it exists offline without additional equivalent. It must be viewed in the context for which it was created, a darkened room that demands full, complete immersion and attentiveness. Bridging the gap between still and moving images, Autoportrait was awarded the 2018 Deutsche Börse Prize for Photography. Thompson's sensuous piece has been celebrated and rebuked, hailed on the one hand as an elegiac reclamation of its subject's strength, dignity, and humanity. On the other hand, it's been the target of protest and withering critique since Thompson's nomination for the 2018 Turner Prize by critics who view it as an aestheticization of black trauma, equating it with Dana Schutz's controversial piece, Open Casket, which depicted an abstracted rendering of Emmett Till's disfigured face in the posthumous photo his mother insisted be published to decry his savage lynching in 1955. Citing Hannah Black's warning in her response to the piece that, quote, non-black artists who sincerely wish to highlight the shameful nature of white violence should first of all stop treating black pain as raw material. Writer Nick Scammell on the photography website ASX contends, quote, Reynolds is known because she refused to be silent, yet Autoportrait sees her both speechless and distanced into black and white film, detached, disconnected, inert. As a New Zealander of Fiji heritage, Thompson has described himself as a black artist, albeit not of the African diaspora. It is an attribution I believe we must take seriously, as positioning him in a place of adjacency rather than identity with the forms of black violence his piece so prominently evokes. It is the adjacency of sitting next to your partner in a car and witnessing his murder, then attempting to talk down the police officer who shot him while capturing it on a cell phone and broadcasting it live to the world to bear witness to both your loss and your refusal to silence his slaughter. Autoportrait demands that we listen to the quiet image of Diamond Reynolds. As Scammell rightly asserts, Reynolds' act of defiance was her refusal to remain silent. Autoportrait renders her neither silent nor speechless. In the carefully constructed, still-moving image Thompson creates, he captures her articulating a devastating critique through a resounding frequency of quiet that rests our undivided attention. This collaborative portrait of refusal, a refusal to be silenced or to accept the status of black disposability, is amplified by a refusal to accept words or speech as either adequate or commensurate to the gravity of her loss, or the monumentality of the crime of devalued black life. Autoportrait forces us to engage with a black woman who overwhelms us through her reserve, control, and containment. It forces us to reckon with the everyday labor that black women have mastered since captivity, carrying loss with dignity, mourning in plain sight, and at the same time refusing to capitulate to the mundane regularity of black death. It forces us to do the work of feeling uncomfortable and grappling with her grief. Such careful cinematic and curatorial practices reveal some of the profound forms of effective labor black visuality both requires and demands. It is the labor of navigating an emotional response to what I call the hapticity of black life. Hapticity is an effortful practice of exertion in any particular form of struggle. It is the struggle to remain in relation to contact or connection with another. It is the labor required to feel across difference, precarity, and suffering. Hapticity is not empathy. It is not feeling for another. It is the work of feeling precarious or feeling precarity in relation to differentially valued or devalued bodies in the absence of any guarantee of respite, respect, or recognition. It is a gamble that will likely end in failure, that is worth taking the risk nonetheless. Truth be told, a silent portrait of any black woman is categorically unbearable. Our refusal of words is inevitably embraced as an invitation to impose a narrative that we have neither authored nor authorized. Set against the backdrop of the story Diamond Reynolds refused not to tell, why do we demand to hear her tell it again? Why do we expect or demand her to repeat it or to tell it differently? Why is this account of it, without words or speech, but in subtle gestures that have an effective power that exceeds words, not enough? Why is it so discomforting to have to listen to what we are seeing, and in doing so, to be accountable to the effective labor of connecting across her quiet to engage that which exceeds words? Pushing these questions uncomfortably forward, Mike Thompson's decision to strip down our quiet encounter with Diamond Reynolds, and by proxy our encounter with Philando Castile and the murder that Reynolds allowed us to witness in its wake, to a monochromatic quiet encounter with Black death and Black refusal to embrace the precarity of Black life, might in fact be utterly appropriate. If not, what script, words, speech, text would have been commensurate? Ultimately, the quiet, still-moving image of Diamond Reynolds' refusal to embrace silence is, to me, a powerful modality of reckoning with the impact of the ongoing war currently being waged against Black bodies. It is a still-moving image of refusal, a refusal to explain, a refusal to capitulate, a refusal to be anything else than who we are,
even at the cost of death. Thank you. Sweet. Good presentation. Hi, everyone. Thank you, Wayne and Sheena, co-conspirators. And everyone for coming, and also to Saidiya Hartman. And what I want to talk about today is, can everybody hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is an archive that I feel has been neglected for a number of political and cultural reasons that very much speaks to questions of refusal and radical hope, and that archive is contemporary R&B music, particularly by Black femme, Black female performers. The recent prominence of Black Lives Matter and the broader groundswell of the movement for Black lives, marked both by the strenuous refusal of the anti-Black status quo and radicalized modalities of hope, has once again put pressure on Black art and music to become more politicized, in order to address the continued disregard of Black life by state and non-state institutions in most parts of the world. Not surprisingly, this politicization has most often taken the path of highlighting how the violence of white supremacy affects cisgendered and heterosexual Black male persons in the public sphere. Given that R&B music focuses on Black everyday livingness, interiority, interpersonal relationships from female-femme perspectives, the genre, in my estimation, shines a spotlight on the quote-unquote minor aspects of the genocidal conditions that shape the continued existence of Black life in the Western world. Thus, for me, rather than hearing contemporary R&B music as a retreat from the political, as is often the case, and building on Somali-Canadian R&B singers among most lyrics, everywhere but here is complicated, scream my name like a protest, I want to briefly today talk about how recent R&B music centers Black femme-defined interpersonal intimacy, interiority, and practices of care. Consequently, these musical and cultural formations offer important Black political imaginaries beyond the cis-heteromasculine precincts of the traditionally political, quote-unquote. I would like to ask, How do the sonic tapestries and vocal calisthenics of current R&B generate sounding sanctuaries of Black feminists that function as political shelters, as hopeful healing spaces from the genocidal storms of anti-Blackness? And just briefly, as context, R&B is the only popular music category in which Black female and femme performers dominate. R&B is also the musical field concerned mostly with interpersonal relationships. And while it is considered to be a Black genre due to the racial identity of most of its performers and its fan base of primarily Black women and Black queer men, and in the history of R&B in general, obvious socio-political overtones remain a rarity. Generally, political sentiment is articulated along the lines of respect, the change is going to come, etc., and so on, that can be applied to both the interpersonal private sphere as well as the public political sphere. And we can even go back to 19th century Negro spirituals to hear that double voiceness. But it's very rarely about storming the barricades or, you know, creating new systems of government, at least not the traditional ones. And this has led, in the contemporary moment, to a critical devaluation of R&B music. R&B music as an art form, but also as a space of Black femme creative and effective labor. And I'm interested here in both the alternate modalities of the political offered by R&B music, as well as the effective labor carried out by the Black femme singing voice as a prime location for the productivity of the Black somatic. It seems very weird. We would do well to follow Kara Keeling's lead and imagine how the Black femme offers, and I'm quoting here, a glimpse into the range of mechanisms whereby transformations within and alternatives to existing organizations of life might be affected. We apprehend the Black femme as a figure that exists on the edge of the visible and the invisible. And I think this also speaks to what Tina Campt was talking about in terms of the visual practices and Black contemporary visual practices, serving as a portal through which present impossibilities might appear. End quote. At the precarious threshold where audibility, inaudibility, imperceptibility, perceptibility reverberate with and against each other, a Black femme analytic unlocks the portal to a vestibular geography of different modes of beautiful Black queer hope and refusal, living and healing. What would it mean to center Black feminists rather than continuing and deepening its disregard, a disrespect often based in both the appropriation and expropriation of Black femme effective physical, cultural, intellectual, and reproductive labor in the academy and beyond? And just to give you a few concrete examples, the performance of effective labor can be perceived, I always want to turn, in contemporary R&B music, most clearly in the way that there is a very deep symbiosis between Black femme R&B performers and reality shows. And so much so that it's impossible to exist as a Black femme R&B performer without having some tie into a reality show at one point or another, either at the beginning of the career or to revive a career, as in the case of Toni Braxton and Mariah Carey. And as journalist Michael Arsenault highlights, reality shows have allowed Black female singers to have the sort of three-dimensional representation their record labels could never provide for them. And there's also another sort of economic and structural story here about how the recording industry has basically abandoned R&B, particularly Black femme performers. And so what these shows do, on the one hand, is provide R&B singers with the drama and narrative arc seemingly necessary to appeal to present-day audiences. And one of my favorite examples, particularly in terms of politics of refusal, is a few years ago, former Destiny's Child member Latavia Roberson was on a reality show called R&B Divas Atlanta. And throughout the course of the show, when she was on it, she refused to sing. because she said that she both had psychic and physical disabilities that were impeding on her ability to sing. Of course, the show completely exploited her conditions, but I thought it was a really powerful moment in terms of her saying, I'm going to appear on the show, but I'm not actually going to sing what you're and do what you're asking me to do. The other thing that also frequently occurs is that Black femme, I keep turning in the wrong direction, that Black femme performers are asked to exploit their past and current histories of trauma, particularly of intimate partner and sexual violence, right? This is what gives them drama and a story arc. So on the one hand, it's necessary for these performers to exist in this world and have careers, but on the other hand, oftentimes it comes not only with having to exploit it, but having their stories of experiencing trauma and violence continually challenged in order to create dramatic tensions on these shows. And where I think, you know, something else comes in is that this reality show world has been picked up by several R&B performers in their work, and most prominently, it's happened on Jasmine Sullivan's 2015 album, and I'll play a clip from it in a second, Reality Show, where she writes songs in the voices of stock Black femme characters on these reality shows, giving them a different kind of image, agency, and just stories, right? So she's creating a different kind of archive of effective labor that is dependent on the reality shows, but also resituates them. And this happens most poignantly on her song, Mascara. And let me just play, hopefully this will play. There's no sound. Can you turn it up? No. So I'll just talk until it's turned up. Are we good?
Yeah.
It's better than nothing. Thank you. Of a reality show character who looks pretty for a living, doesn't have a traditional job, etc., and so on. And what Jasmine Sullivan does to these characters, as I said, is to give them particularly an interior life in a way they're usually not allowed to inhabit in these reality shows. And the song's chorus maintains, I never leave the house without makeup on. I keep mascara in my pocket if I'm running to the market, because you never know who's watching, so I got it. Stay on. Black feminist appears as a recurring cycle of techniques that require vigilance, constant negotiation, refusal, upkeep, and of course, labor, which while generating worth are disparaged in the world that we inhabit. Mascara takes on the form of the character Sullivan portrays responding to her distractors, both imagined and real, as representatives of the devaluation of Black femme labor, especially those forms of work associated with physical appearance and beauty, usually deemed useless, frivolous, excessive, and not labor at all. And the character, Jasmine Sullivan singing it, responds thus, no, I ain't got a job, but so what? I don't need it when I'm getting everything that I want. It's a small price to pay when you're living this good, end quote. Of course, the narrator does in fact have an occupation, which is creating and conforming to traditional ideas of feminine beauty for which she is remunerated, right? This verse concludes with the following queries. Don't I deserve to be privileged? don't I deserve to get the very best? Why are these questions even necessary? Because clearly she is worthy of the best and all the privilege even before she makes up her face and carries the mascara to the grocery store with her. Sullivan adds to the complexity of black femme effective labor by centering and sounding the labor of a specific kind of black feminist and also noticeably marking the distinction between art and artists. And this is one of the things that also tends to happen in R&B and the reality show, is that these lyrics are oftentimes sort of read as purely autobiographical and not in any way art and imaginative. So when she sings, "Don't I deserve to be privileged?" And the other thing that happens, and I'm just going to talk through this because I think it will just take us a little bit too far away. The other thing that I'm working through here in this project in terms of refusal is this fundamental shift in the style of R&B singing, a movement away from the kind of big, melismatic, church-trained voices of an Aretha Franklin and Whitney Houston towards this more interior, vulnerable space that is created by these different forms of quiet R&B singing. And Jasmine Sullivan works as one of the prime examples for me because she has that church training, but oftentimes in her art she chooses not to use it, but modulates her voice in all these different ways. Also interesting in these gendered ways. And what seems to me really interesting in terms of the shift in R&B singing is that black artists have primarily moved away from this melismatic singing as the primary sort of sound of blackness, but have found all these other ways to still sound unmistakably black, while the Celine Dions and the Adeles do the melismatic singing at this point in time. And overall, I argue that the use of the singing and speaking voices in these ways creates different kinds of black femisonic intimacies. And it also refuses the performance of the type of effective labor expected and demanded of black femme R&B singers, as on reality shows. Besides the wide juxtaposition of singing styles, vocal registers, and samples, and so on, the last few years has seen this development of an almost ambient dub reggae type of R&B singing. And it is usually read as a kind of decline in R&B singing, but also as not political, right? And I'm claiming it as an archive of a specific kind of black femme politics and effective labor. Labor that turn inward rather than outward and perform interiority. Thus, R&B becomes the repository for black femme vulnerability by undertaking the labor of sounding a wide variety of interiorities and intimacies that are necessary for the existence of the properly political in the contemporary moment. And then, the next example. Contemporary R&B. The other example is Blood Orange's Sandra's Smile, which is about Sandra Bland's smile and the circulation of the images in the aftermath of her death. And what I really deeply appreciate about the song, beyond the musical aspects, is that it creates lyrically this continuity between bedroom intimacy and the street and protest, right? And it also, this idea of scream my name like a protest both makes reference to the long history of R&B songs that want one's intimate partner to say their name for a variety of reasons, like Destiny's Child, Say My Name. But also in the contemporary moment, it makes a reference to Say Her Name, which highlights the neglect of how police violence affects Black femme bodies. And so this song brings the street to the bedroom while at the same time draping the purportedly private and apolitical boudoir linens all over the street signs in the neighborhood, so that the rally now serves not only to draw attention to the killing of specific Black persons and to demand the abolition of police brutality and all carceral apparatuses, but it also becomes about transmuting the avenue, the street where the protest happens, into a series of possibilities for a different world. And I'm just gonna wrap up here. I had another non-musical example, but I'll just move over from this. So among many other things, the temporary, what I learned from contemporary R&B is to remain vigilant about the deep entanglements between the interpersonal, affective, interior, intimate, and the capital P, political, while also not forgetting that both political refusal and radical imaginaries of hope begin in one's immediate surrounding, whether this is the bedroom, the street, the classroom, the faculty lounge, or the subway car. This also, R&B also summons, to summon Kara Keeling again, creates a Black femme portal through which present impossibilities might appear at the effectively charged interstices of I can't breathe and waiting to exhale. Thank you.
Thank you. And for Tina doing what was necessary so that we could be here. I don't have a paper proper, but a series of thoughts which haven't been properly edited because I wasn't able to print my talk out before, and I'm very bound to paper for my thinking. But that raise these questions related to refusal and hope, pessimism and impossibility. So I'll just, you know, share these ranging thoughts. So maybe an opening gambit with some of the questions. How do those denied the right to live live? It is a state defined by vulnerability to premature death and to gratuitous violence, and without an available grammar to describe it, and yet which yields a surplus that proves capable of sustaining Black life. A cluster of terms might be collated to explain this condition: hope, despair, nihilism, tragedy, precarity, catastrophe, disposability, nothingness, heartbreak, and lovelessness. Refusal is a mode of Black thought and practice that registers the ontological wounds of Black being in the world. It is much a critical mode of reflection on the world as it is an intuitive recognition that the world is against me, that it is impossible for me to live, that it is impossible to breathe, that makes the struggle to exist, to survive from one day to the next, not something to be taken for granted, but which requires devoted attention, necessitates a plan, because time doesn't belong to you, but is borrowed. What pessimism / refusal, and here I'm trying to open up this, like, and break this binarism between something called pessimism and something called vitalism, and to think about what refusal engenders. But what pessimism underscores is the refusal of the terms of the given, or any possibility of meaning in an anti-Black world, or a world which fails to live, which fails to yield a grammar to describe this state, where that registers an ontological and ethical disruption, a crisis in the knowledge of the world, and one place in it that might provide an entry point to another horizon of possibility. Pessimism or refusal is not the same as hopelessness, but is a refusal to believe in or invest in the very same institutions that have engendered the crisis. To have no faith in the liberal state which has licensed Black Death and dispossession for centuries, one refuses to believe that at this late hour that this state might save us from fascism, might be capable of producing a future not predicated on death, fungibility, precarity, and disposability. Du Bois wrote about a quality of hope in which I am most interested, a hope that is not hopeful, but not hopeless. Related to this is a question about what the failure to translate this hope, which is not hopeful, but not hopeless, the failure to translate this quality of hope into political hope, or the refusal to translate the experience of not being able to live into a politics of appeal or recognition might yield. So here I'm trying to, have us hesitate to translate, a certain experience of dissonance and loss in the world into legible political claims. And I prefer to think about pessimism as a decided failure of political legibility that invites us to imagine the promise of a future world wrought by the dispossessed, the remainder, the disposable, the disconnected, and the surplus, and as a refusal of a language may be predicated on rights or the claim for recognition or redress or the investment in a politics of fulfillment, a politics legible and consonant with the prevailing terms of political rationality. What set of desires and aspirations exceed the terms of the given, and that might be considered and elaborated along the lines laid out by both Tina and Alex, and along the lines Richard Eitan described in terms of the Black fantastic. The question shadowing this one is whether those constituted as the other and marginalized by the terms of modernity can articulate their aspirations and challenge this exclusion and rewrite the text of their dehumanization in the terms constituted by that modernity. Eitan, like Alex, like Tina, considered the significance of Black cultural practice to the making of Black politics, and basically is unwilling to confine the question of the aesthetic or the artistic to a separate realm from the matter of politics lower key. The fantastic, or the politics of transfiguration, or the wild thought that exceeds the terms of the given, might unsettle the very forms of governmentality and the conventional notions of the political, the public sphere, the civil society that depend on the exclusion of Blacks and other non-whites from meaningful participation and their ongoing reconstitution as raw material for the naturalization of modern arrangements. So I can't think hope without hesitancy, without the caution to proceed slowly, less to avoid defeat than in the fear of recreating the very worlds in relation that we hope to escape and transform. To speak plainly, there is no need to translate hope and the imagination of the social otherwise into a formula for democratic politics. To trim the excesses of the unsayable and funnel wild visions and unrealizable aspirations, at least in the present, of what might be intelligible claims of the politics of fulfillment, or truncate a radical blueprint of planetary existence into the political platform of settler democracy and the crumbling liberal state. Here I'm trying to think about the right to exist and about the ways that remaindered life deemed disposable and its ways to the order of racial capitalism's value production creates value and sociality that cannot be and refuses to be absorbed by the machine. A black life politics at the side of or in the company of those for whom politics seems impossible and impoverished. This line of consideration requires us to consider what we might do in the meantime. And I'm thinking of this meantime as it's a kind of like spatial temporal configuration that Du Bois often invoked as, you know, dusk, or he described as the long siege in his essay on my evolving problem of Negro freedom, as the moment when neither education, protest, agitation, struggle, or appeal will staunch the violence of an anti-black world. And so we need to devote our full attention to matters of survival. Plainly put, the counterintuitive question stated simply might be, what might those who are so clearly failing to live right or to live at all, and who are denied the right to live at all, might teach us about possibility, about potentiality, about otherwise? Perhaps I have drawn too stark a picture of an anti-black world and one that fails to capture or convey the optimism or hope that Wayne's invitation prompt was intended to explore, but not encourage. And Mbembe describes this current moment of global crisis and revanchism as the blackening of the world, because the term or in the condition of the black has become generalized, and others too have been forced to experience this new fungibility that has been institutionalized, he writes, as a new norm of existence and expanded to the entire planet. I think the work of Du Bois offers a critical lesson for any who would assume that the destitution and precarity of the white working class presumes a disinvestment in the project of whiteness and that a burgeoning solidarity might unfold under the auspices of the becoming black of the world, because as we're all experiencing, the response to this crisis seems to be, the blossoming of the most brutal forms of white nationalism everywhere, in the West. So the cruel optimism offered by white sovereignty is that no matter how bad things get, the ruling elite still exercise a monopoly on life, can own the earth forever and ever, and continue to make the future in the image of the past. Cruel optimism offers the lure that we save the liberal project, and that if we prove willing to do so, there might be, in the end, a place for us too. To lay the foundation of something new, we must, as Du Bois conjures in The Comet, which is a speculative fiction which I will talk about in a minute, we must imagine the end of the world. We must wish for it. We must invite it. In The Comet, a work of speculative fiction published in Du Bois' 1919 collection, Dark Water, in, I think, 1919, almost exactly a century from, before ours, this desire for the end of the world and the emergence of a new set of relations literally require the destruction of the world. Only the end of a known world is capable of creating a world in which the human isn't the exclusive property of whiteness, and the human is capable of producing an outcome other than a huge pile of corpses. In The Comet, as well as in his other speculative fiction, Princess Steel, he comes close to imagining a world without racial distinctions, a world where white folks can see and feel and think the cost of their civilization. the hope is that by owning this violence, that there is a welcoming, an invitation to the dissolution or abolition of whiteness, to which Du Bois is also referring to the larger terms of a Western imperial and colonial project. But Du Bois suggests with equal parts hope and despair that the world itself must end, for the afterlife of slavery or colonialism or slavery in all but name and racial capitalism to be defeated. And I'll just describe the story briefly and end with a few questions. In the short story Comet, Du Bois imagines an end to the anti-black world and whites and the white sovereignty masked as democracy. The entire city here in New York is destroyed. In fact, the world is raised before the two figures at the center of the story. A black man and a white woman can meet as humans, not as master and slave, not as man and other. So this is the story. Jim Davis is a kind of a precursor of the invisible man in his subterranean cave. He is a kind of a low-level worker at the bank who is forced to go to the lower vaults of the bank to retrieve important documents when a comet hits the earth and releases poisonous gases. He is in the sunken place in the bowels of the earth, a crypt engulfed in blackness, a womb abyss. Locked away in this space, he is safe from the disaster. When he ascends to the dead world, Jim is now able to eat at a famous hotel that would not have served him before. In this dead world, he is human. In this dead world, the beautiful white woman, Julia, the only other survivor in the city, for the first time, does not notice that he was a Negro. Quote, he had not thought of her as white. Yesterday, he thought with bitterness, she would have scarcely looked at him twice. He would have been dirt beneath her feet. Not that he was not human, but that he dwelt in a world so far from hers, so infinitely far, that he seldom even entered her thought. End quote. She thinks, quote, he did not look like men as she had always pictured men. He was something more than a stranger. Du Bois stresses the distance between the Negro and the human in the eyes of this beautiful white woman who Jim Davis has rescued. More frightening than death itself is the fear of black criminality on Julia's part. This fear can't be assuaged, so despite Jim Davis's cool reserve, Julia fears that he might be a brute. And even with the world gone, what she fears most is him and what he might do. Not that, she pleads, and he answers slowly, no, not that. Only in the graveyard of the world could she see him as human. Only the end of the world offers the possibility of seeing him not as an alien, a predator, a form of life even more foreign than the stranger. Only death affords the dream of some vast romance. Only in the great dead city did he appear for the first time. Like her, human. How foolish are human distinctions, she says. He replies, yes, I was not human yesterday. In the graveyard of the world, the vision of a mighty beauty, of vast unspoken things, swelled in their souls, but they put it away. In the graveyard of the world, their souls lay naked into the night. It was not lust, it was not love, it was some vaster, mightier things that needed neither touch, a body, or thrill of soul. It was a thought divine and splendid, end quote. At the moment of their embrace, the words they utter in unison, words much more promising and important than I love you are. The world is dead. That is the beauty and promise afforded by the comet. But alas, the world isn't dead, and Julia is united with her proper white paramour and the crowd of white men who arrived to confront the black savior, returning him to the world. Quote, a nigger, where is he? Let's lynch the damned. Jim Davis has not lost everything as he feared. The small and toil-worn woman who is his wife appears with the corpse of a dark baby in her arm. Life, yes, but not defined or secured by reproductive futurity as the dead child in the arms of the mother made plain, but a future described by Henry Highland Garnet, in which even the unborn are conscripted, a world where mothers shroud their children and black fathers grieve the loss of the firstborn. It is, alas, heartbreaking image of the child, the children gone and not allowed to live, who force us to look into the face of death and smile and to say how beautiful it was to die. But the question cannot be avoided. Is this life? How can we survive the death of our children? How can we live in this murderous world? It is a question that Du Bois faces squarely, ask in a half whisper, this death, is this life? And is its beauty real or false? It is a heart questioning, he writes, an uncertainty, something unnameable, unspeakable, unspoken, yet vast, concerns matters of life and death. The question returns, how can, how might we live? What might be capable of undoing this world and cultivating a new set of arrangements, a different planetary scheme? Thank you.
Now Saidiya closed with not in her closing, but she provoked my concern, my own concern for the question of hope as perhaps a conversation that takes a more positive direction. And actually it is so, and this is one of the things we want to open with. It is so that I make a very, very great distinction between ever thinking that I can be optimistic in the world. There's nothing to be optimistic about. And so I'm interested exactly in the ways you structure it around the question of pessimism. Because I see hope not as the same thing at all. And in a funny way, sometimes I'm led to think, and I must admit, I want to thank you all. I forgot that this, and I'm going to be quite vulnerable here to suggest that this reading, this set of conversation makes me also feel vulnerable in a certain sense too. Because perhaps there is something about what has been happening recently, whether or not it is Donald Trump or Brexit or what happens in Germany or here, that sometimes invites me to even think just to live is hope. Just to live might be an act of revolution in a certain sense. So it is in no way an invitation for happiness in a certain simplistic way to think about it, but rather, and I will go back to a material culture thing that I always do. I'm a little bit love objects, and this is not a real object. Where I come from a really tiny town. It's called Bog Walk. Really, really tiny. There are not many people here. And one of the things that has always fascinated me growing up, all of my life, is that when people built houses, the urban, the poor, the rural poor, they built houses and they built slowly, extremely slowly. You can't afford it. It's impossible to afford it. But what you do is that you build so much as the bottom floor, and all of you will occupy that house.
And then what you do is that you leave these steel things on the top. And the steel things on the top is a promise. It is an imagination. It's actually an imagination of inaugurating another kind of world where that livability is possible and you're going to grow over. And I was surprised going to St. Lucia for the first time and seeing them doing it differently. Because in St. Lucia, they build the stilts, then they finish the house with the roof, and after that, they fill in the bottom. And that's a very different logic, because the
bottom that they fill in is going to be that place that you you rent out so that you can survive. And I've always thought there was a two different logic of the material going on there, which again,
I want to ask the question, is the attendance to Black life under the violence, the impossibility, the death of slavery, an attendance not to optimism, but a possibility for hope? But before I move to that, I want to just open with one little thing of refusal. Just a little bit of a, because I was taking notes there, and I'm interested in the concept of adjacency. And as you suggested, Tina, adjacency not necessarily as a form of identity in the sense, but what it might mean to share along a particular line. And when I'm at the adjacency, it could be seen as a particular act of the solidarity without not empathy. Mm-hmm. So I'm interested in that. But I, to open for you, refusal, I just want to quote you, a rejection of the status quo as livable and the creation of possibility in the face of negation. Refusal to recognize a system that renders you fundamentally illegible and unintelligible. The decision to reject the terms of diminished subjecthood. And this causes me to, my final kind of wrapping up comment for this, causes me to also think of locating this within the Netherlands and the context in which we live. And the context here of where are those possible spaces of refusal. And as I listened to Alex, one of the things that I realized, how much the battle with the archives that I've come to know, and I've only been here 8 years, so I could be wrong, always constitutes the colonized, quote-unquote, new world subject as having a history, two histories. One is the Maroons, and the second one is colonialism, in a particular sense. So we never know about the musical history, a development of a 20th century musical history in Suriname, Curacao, anywhere. We don't know those histories, those archives, as if they don't exist. We never really know, and I know that somebody is going to tell me about there's one book, but that's exactly my problem. There's one book.
My friend is gay.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly it. So it works. So I'm interested in asking that question. What kind of project of power limits the possibility of us even seeing these kinds of archives as usable, necessary, valued, for them to come to the fore, for them to be collected, to be narrated, to be worked again and again? Because in the presence that we have, and this is a really interesting moment now, that much of the work that we do, many of us in the audience, work not on those histories of refusal, but histories of colonial as an end past. I'm interested in where are those other kinds of archives that we can see. So, I'm not optimistic, but I still want to ask you about if an attention to those archives is a possibility for you, for thinking hope otherwise. Can I ask if any of you want to respond to any of yourselves? If any of you want to tell me that hope is useless and I should move on from it, I'm sorry, that's what.
before we open to you as the floor, and it is an insistence of RCMC that you need to ask questions. You're not here to just go and listen to people, all right? So that's a part of the need, the requirement. Any responses to each other first?
So the question of optimism that Saidiya put on the table, I think that was also in our initial conversations, right? When we were talking about whether or not it's possible to use the term hope at this particular moment in time and not have it invoke optimism is actually the kinder term, you know, as opposed to naivete, right? Or just foolishness, you know? And that the pressure point for me in those early conversations was not, you know, trying to rehabilitate hope, but trying to think about the possibility of radical hope, right? What does radical do? What kind of pressure can it put on hope? And in what way does it push us to reflect on something that does not tether hope to optimism? And then also over the course of the last few weeks, I've been working for, you know, as part of the Sojourner Project and the organizing for the Practicing Refusal convening in Paris, I've been working with a group of feminists who have just, like, you know, opened my mind to a lot of really captivating ideas and ways of imagining this thing that we're referencing uncomfortably with radical hope. And I think, and Françoise Vergès is one of those people who, she offered the question of radical promise, right? She offered that term, which is to think beyond life as survival, right? To actually begin to think about what you're talking about of, you know, what if we were to consider, to think, to imagine, right? Again, to marshal the power of imagination to think beyond optimism, but to think about our entitlement to the promise of thriving, right? That if the black subject, that the radical act is a black subject imagining their entitlement to thrive and not simply to exist beyond, you know, the state of emergency. And that is a radical potential, a radical act, but it's also a radical act of imagination that is extraordinarily powerful. And then I just wanted to comment on what your question about adjacency, which I also find incredibly useful. And for me, adjacency is related to that notion of practice that I'm trying to develop, which is, you know, to think about proximity as making you vulnerable when you are not the target of annihilation, right? So if we were to actually consider adjacency as not simply being beside or in solidarity with, but literally being vulnerable to that which is targeting another, what forms of responsibility, what forms of precarity do you have to force yourself to work through, right? And to me, that's a very, very different framework for thinking about sociality. And it's necessary in this moment, because otherwise what we get is the me versus you, or the, you know, it's them over there. Then, you know, the notion of proximity is utterly negated. So that's what I would respond to.
I mean, I guess I'm still mulling over the hope bit. I mean, I'm much more comfortable with hope than I am with optimism. Because that seems to me, it doesn't only seem foolish, it seems foolish in the sense of, you know, why don't you just go ahead and kill yourself if you're going to be optimistic. But, Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking about the whole archive question, and I think, you know, clearly, maybe not in the context that you're talking about, but I think that a lot of the, I would say, historiographical work in the U.S. and other parts of Black diaspora studies has sort of been about unearthing those kinds of archives, what might have been, right, et cetera, and so on. And I think that, you know, thinking about all of our three of our work together, that all of us are sort of not necessarily looking for spaces of optimism or hope or things like that, but trying to, in very, very different ways, create, unearth, keep alive these archives where moments of refusal and hope happen, right? Whether this is in art or in more historical, in your case, again, with me, with contemporary R&B music. And I do think that especially in moments that are perceived as moments of extreme crisis, right? That the tendency is to move away from, I think you called it micro-labors, mm-hmm. right? And to me, I guess what I would want to hold on to is creating archives broadly construed of those micro labors, those micro frustrations, joys, like moments of livingness, right, that don't necessarily have to be optimistic or positive, but just sort of exist in, I want texture and complexity. And I oftentimes find, and musically speaking, for instance, one of the things that I noticed, particularly with R&B, but also with other music, when artists have tried to make explicitly political Black Lives Matter songs, they're usually horrible, right? They're horrible on every single level. They're like politically simplistic. They're as works of art or just works of enjoyment. They're not that great. So it's always been, for me, you know, hearing those moments where the linkages between the politics on the street and the politics in the kitchen, in the bedroom, et cetera, and so on, happen. And I most clearly hear that in music, but I think you can also see it in other places. And I think, and I think part of, for me, what's important about sort of bearing witness to this is how quickly this disappears. So for instance, these reality shows, of which there are many in the United States, there's only two available on DVD. There's two reality shows involving Black femme R&B singers. The others are not accessible. You can access clips, right? Clips of, you know, the participants being violent to each other, acting sassy, throwing shade, et cetera, and so on. But you don't get the actual, that as an actual archive. So to me, yeah, it's important to not necessarily preserve it, but to kind of keep living with those with those things, because I do find that they give me a different sort of view on the world and how to engage with the world than other things. So I'll just stop there.
I guess I would just make a small comment. I mean, I think that often when that term hope is being mobilized politically, there's really a very anemic conception of what's possible, and that hope is a call to stand behind a very mainstream dictated liberal project. Like, we're being mobilized to, in fact, to do the same things in relation to the same kind of institutions, and to refuse that call is then to be, you know, labeled a pessimist or a refusenik or a destituent, or, and so, I mean, hope is double-edged as well, because it can be, you know, the privileged term of a certain project of reproduction.
Before I want to open up to the audience, man, but I just want to put it on the agenda so I remember it, because I'm good at forgetting. Is the question, going back to the question of imagination and what that might mean, especially as you alluded to or mentioned, to imagine the end of a particular world or beyond a particular world for another kind of future. Questions from the audience? And don't hold your hands up all at once.
Oh,
second person who could take two. Is there another one? Okay, so we take Martin first. It's not growing now.
I'm not sure if this question makes sense because maybe it's not as binary, but I wonder, does refusal sort of imply revolution, or does it imply isolationism? Does it imply transformation, or does it imply retreat? Because I feel that refusal can be two things, right? It can be refusing and affecting change, or refusing and saying, I'm going to retreat into my own space, into my own interior community, etc. So I said, I'm not sure if it's that binary, but I think it can be both things. And I wonder also what that means in relation to hope, because hope for me is more of this communal idea of moving towards something which is better, so it's more this revolutionary sense in a way. And especially in relation to sort of this apocalyptic vision of change and revolution that you've sketched in, where, you know, a comet has to destroy everything and everyone in order for us to be better. I was wondering if you could elaborate on that.
And there's a second question next to you. Yes.
Should I ask it?
Right? Yes, go ahead.
I'm sorry if this question is not fully formulated, and if it doesn't, I'll just blame on the fact that English is my second language. To start off as an example, I am taking a class currently here on migration, and for the first exercise, the professor presented this question, should Europe accept refugees or not? And you're not allowed to bring any type of like connecting issue, like whether colonialism or postcolonialism, any of that is not the object of interrogation. The thing that we should discuss currently is, should Europe accept refugees or not? And just for my own sake, because I refuse to engage in things like this, I refuse to say anything, and then we went on, and most of the people who engaged were, you know, white Europeans, and the outcome of it was, you know, something that would mimic the UN's response to refugees and the catastrophes that take place here. And so part of me felt a little bit bad, because had I engaged in and put in some effort of my own input, a different response for refugees could have been given, but also it would never be enough. It has never been enough. And so, you know, part of me was able to live with that. But I feel like refusal also has with itself, you know, proximity to which you can refuse to engage and not engage. I grew up in Ethiopia and Kenya, and in those times, I would say that I was, me and my family and people around me were able to engage with the refusal less because we had less choice to refuse. But, you know, the more you gain some sort of material privilege or just some sort of privilege, you can refuse to engage in something or not engage in something. And this time it feels like refusing to engage, it is looking more and more dangerous, because not refusing seems like the world goes on regardless. And I'm not sure if you're referring to being mobilized to vote currently in the US. There's a vote going on, and the liberal platform for that is to just go out and vote and vote and vote. You know, it doesn't really matter for whom, and it doesn't really matter how much trouble voting for these people has gotten us into. So I wonder what your response is. Refusal, but that refusal puts you in more danger to die, more or less, especially, you know, for black bodies. So I wonder what that looks like.
I kind of want to address both of your questions at once by saying that when I'm talking about refusal, I'm not talking about I'm going to participate or not. I'm talking about the category of participation. So in that question that you just posed in your class about migration, the question of should Europe accept refugees, that the category of the European and the refugee is fundamentally wrong. Right? Fundamentally, does Europe have the right to refuse entry of people, of humans, right, on the basis of what? The nation state? On the basis of citizenship? Right? Is it, so is the basis of your capacity to live in Europe, what is that based on? Citizenship. And what is citizenship based on? Right? These categories to me make no sense. Right? But right now they are functioning under this other rubric of the European, right? Which is very, very new. Right? Which is very, very new in this iteration. But that category has systematically functioned, right, in different iterations, right, to enforce certain boundaries, right? So my response to that question is, what makes sense about that question? I refuse the very terms on which you are constituting a European and a refugee, right, as oppositional or as a question of volition, or a question of permission, right? So for me, again, refusal is not participating in that conversation, but literally challenging the categories on which it is based as, in any way, shape, or form, legitimate, right? As well as, right, the all of the collateral damage, right? All the collateral injuries, erasures, negations on which it is premised, right? So refusal in that way is not that binary of I'm in or out, right? I'm going to talk to you, I'm not going to talk to you, right? It is about the recognition of the inadequacy of the very terms of the conversation, right? So that the mode of engagement is not yes or no or in and out. The mode of engagement is to actually question, right, who gets to inhabit any of these positions in the proposition that this is a dialogue, right? So that is where I would begin, right? Because that undermines the capacity of anybody to actually speak to me, right?
I guess I would say that there are many ways to be active and to be involved in the work of transformation. And I think partly, there's a hegemonic vocabulary of what it means to be a political actor. And so I think that's what is, that we're really questioning here. And I mean, the way your question is related to yours, I mean, under the regime of hope, under Obama, there was the largest loss of black wealth since the Great Depression. So under the regime of hope, black life became so dramatically less possible. So it's just about, I would say pausing to think about what is afforded by the only routes of transformation that people think are, available to them. And I would say one thing that's interesting about looking at the archive, we get to see the great diversity of black radical projects. So it's not about a quiet retreat. It may be about vocabularies of the possible that are incommensurate or antagonistic to one another, but that, and even like, voter mobilization as opposed to a massive campaign to end the Electoral College. Like, and just the kind of the ways those things remain, separate kinds of issues. So it's not about an individual retreat, it's about a certain return to something called politics proper and the way that marginalizes, silences, and devalue a range of other projects. And I think that many of those other projects might be better suited, better equipped to engendering sustainable kinds of practices. So that's all. It's about a kind of an opening up. I think that's why I tried to think about what is it that refusal yields? What does it make possible? That it's not simply about, it's not a rejection. And I think that the, the range of practices that are beneath the radar of the legible and the visible. Let's hope that they proliferate. And I think that if we actually do some archival investigations, we'll find a number of projects which were like actually brilliant and wonderful. They were defeated, but their defeat is no index of their paucity of imagination, of the paucity of the potentiality. They were simply defeated in their conflict with a great militarized state apparatus.
There were two questions. Right. One first, and then
I would ask about terminology. To my understanding, being optimistic is believing that the world or others will bring you a new, will bring change, and hope is more individual. I'm Palestinian, and when I asked my father once about different things, and then he just said, before I die, I have to tell you one thing. I have one answer for you for any question you ask. The only answer is hope. Be it individual, be it collective, whatever. And hope is seen, the way I understood it, is not as a feeling. It is a decision to act. A decision like to have a strategy, that's hope. It's like self-made hope. Hope is not just like, I think it differs from being optimistic, is that you have to imagine what you are hoping. And the difficulty I see is that when you hope on an individual level, you need others to build strategies with. And at the moment, the depression or pessimism comes from the fact that we don't know what kind of strategies we need to connect to be more than individuals who have these fantastic art projects that are full of hope. We need more. We need more. And I think what Wayne suggested about archives is very, very important. And I would say that it is important to find ways, that's my question to you, if we're talking about culture as connecting to change narratives, to bring more space for connectivity to hope, for change. How can we bring more, I'm going to be very pragmatic. I've been living here 8 years and I've become an Amsterdamer. Pragmatic. How can we get more power and money for projects like that that would shed the light on even this simple thing of archives of whatever, culture? As simple as that. No politics, no nothing.
And the second question.
Oh.
Oh, there. Oh, great. Right here, on the page.
Can everybody hear me? Thank you all for your presentations. I very much enjoyed hearing all of you speak. I just wanted to respond to the question of archives, and this is not as a self-promotion kind of thing, but I'm currently running a platform for queer femme, women of color and black women who could come together in a space, and also like women in a broad sense, to kind of learn how to use say DJing equipment in order to be able to do this kind of research and art into musical archives. And that this is what I've been doing for over the past 5 years, and particularly in the Iranian archives. So I think these projects are happening, but maybe they're not really visible yet. And I know of several other people who are working around the same kind of researches. So maybe they're still a little bit on the ground and we need more connection to, say, public platforms, etc. Just as a response to what is being said.
Can we take another question then, right behind you?
So
So what occurred to me in listening to the talks today was that I'm kind of curious to see how this checks out for you. Is hope as a micro-labor and the connection between hope and death. So death operating on two levels, one in which there's a pronounced element of finality, so death that makes, that brings color to the moment, so that to be completely immersed in death is also to be completely immersed in the bedroom, right? It's to be completely, to be intimate with death is to be intimate with the fact that we are not dead yet. And so that brings a tie between another tie, perhaps, hopefully an appropriate one, between the politics of survival and all, and sort of this archive of the musical archive and the R&B conversation that happened today. But then there's also a kind of death operating in a way that's not final, but a both internal and external falling away or burning away, which would bring Du Bois's dark water onto the table, because it allows for a kind of disidentification from a social conditioning that allows a freedom of imagination, so that in death there is a capacity for also depth and breadth of possibility without even stepping outside of a container. But a kind of internal agency that shifts when the relationship to the social structure is simply perceived. So a kind of agency in leaving the planet in the mind. Which also seems to simply stand next to the statement that Black feminists have been studying for a very long time.
I mean, I guess what I would want to follow up with is just that on the idea in terms of what kind of practices not only exist historically but in the contemporary moment, right? I think, and again, this is one of the things that R&B continually teaches me, is that while the politics with the capital P, there's nothing wrong with it and it's necessary, et cetera, and so on, but that in terms of actually maintaining hope and life, even in the face and in proximity to death, it's often sort of in the micro spaces and in the micro labors that most of the work happens, right? And one of the examples that I use that for me is in line with R&B is last year in one of my seminars, there was a group of students, it was a fairly small seminar, and I said to them they could either do individual final projects or a group project, and they all decided to come together and create a Black queer healing space. And initially I was just like, okay, I couldn't really imagine it. But we had these like very, very extensive conversations after reading Barbara Christian, Alice Walker, Audre Lorde, et cetera, and so on, about what it meant for them to exist in a predominantly white university space, of having made it, right? All not necessarily being from the kind of background that such a university presumes. And it was really instructive for me, because in those 90 minutes in the last session of class, they completely transformed the room that we had been in for, I guess, 11 to 12 weeks. and with very, very small things transformed it into an actual healing space. And so every student had their own station of one of the things that they considered particularly healing, and it ranged from writing to basketball to jewelry making to selfie making. Then there were performances, music, food, etc., and so on. And it was just sort of in that moment, of course, everything didn't disappear that happens in the outside world. But for me, that was one of those micro moments of hope, right? Just in terms of being able, with not very much, materially being able to completely transform that space and turn it into something else by rearranging the lights, by draping a few things there, that it was literally, it became a different kind of space that wasn't, you know, the kind of surveillance, violent sort of university university space. And I'm not saying that that's all it takes, but for me, those micro things are much more instructive in terms of what I think. And of course, at least in the US, and I'm pretty sure here too, that there are a number of initiatives by different groups, people of color, queer groups, etc., and so on, that are not concerned with politics with a capital P, but actually creating the spaces that are livable, even if it's only for 2 hours a week, right? Or an hour, month. And I think that with the newer generation of particularly young Black activists in Chicago, it's very much sort of in line with thinking about the micro labors and the micro activism in relationship to protesting on the street, getting the I think she was the former senator voted out of office, or no, she was the attorney, the attorney general. They mobilized around that, but also creating these types of healing spaces at the same time, because that's what allows people to actually go on, right?
I think I'm going to come back to the archives question, and I can't necessarily answer the practical question. But one of the things that I've always marveled at, and this connects to the first two questions, is the way or the power of, again, sort of doing the micro labor of interrogating existing archives and what you find in them. And so, I mean, I'm really inspired by your work, Saidiya, and your new forthcoming book, where it is about reading about the lives of young Black women within the state archive, right? But not from the perspective of the state. So what is the power of reimagination that is necessary to engage and make visible the lives that only that we find in the archive, but usually we only see them from the perspective of power and subjugation. So I'm very excited that Wayne has arranged a conversation with folks who are doing this work at the Black Archives Group here in Amsterdam, to think about, you know, the fact that such projects do not come with money first, right? They come with the labor first. And that I think that it is, while money certainly opens doors, the most effective projects come from below and not from above.
But you already gave the answer, the reimagining of the existing.
Right. Right, and so,
connecting.
Yeah, and so I guess that's, since I'm not somebody who, you know, we've been talking about this, the shackles of official power and money, right, often impede the very projects that we are trying to achieve. And so...
You have to accept the terms and what you were saying earlier.
Yeah. You have to accept the terms that are presented with them, and, you know, we have to be very crafty. You know, I'm downright, you know, I'm very crafty. One has to be super wily to be able to marshal the resources to do radical work. And that's what I mean about Black feminist beings having to study for a very long time. That I am inspired by that crafty, wily you know, down low kind of work, you know, that cannot be guaranteed success. That's part of the other thing. It cannot be guaranteed that you're not working on the basis of the guarantee of success or recognition or satisfaction or utility. We're doing it against those odds because we know that not that is promised. So when you get, I mean, in that moment, when you achieve that recognition, it also has to be questioned. When somebody's trying to give you money to do something, look at the fine print. Somebody's going to come back around. But again, it's really due diligence.
About the matter of death, I mean, I think in the context of the speculative fiction, Du Bois is simply trying to imagine how might this order end? How might it end? I mean, one of the things that he says about a kind of a racial settler project is it has a monopoly on forever. Forever is, you know, the time it loves the best. He says, you know, to be white, to own the earth forever and ever, so that is a way, simply a way of imagining a break or a rupture. The Anthropocene is another way of thinking about an end, you know, to this order. Two, I think that in this moment of crisis, and as, you know, things are falling away, many people are trying to, like, save a bad relationship. And so so maybe what we need is, yeah, exactly, some, like, you know, radical workshops in imagining otherwise and how to build out, you know, a variety of networks, right? How to produce a social otherwise. So it's not even about that to the exclusion of, you know, getting people out to vote in a context where the project of disenfranchisement is like an official practice of the state. But to just say we need to be creative, right? And just I guess devote time to thinking about the otherwise. Like, I mean, we have a number of brilliant critiques under our finger. And I think that sometimes what appeals to me about, you know, pessimism, I mean, I always have this example. Suppose we said schools as they currently exist have failed black students, continue to fail them, and will fail them. So what do we do? So then if we accepted that as a kind of fact, is there an obligation to then continue a certain kind of appeal, a protest, a kind of, you know, a struggle with, you know, other citizens of our cities and towns who are happy to, you know, mobilize public resources for their own end, or really try to build other kinds of institutions? And I think that one of the things about this moment, which does go to hope, is that because things are so clear, people are involved in building a range of, you know, alternative social institutions. And that's very exciting. So I think that the comet, you know, is not dark. It's about, like, wow, how might white supremacy end? What is the possible scenario when protest has failed, when education has failed, when social reconstruction has failed, when, you know, decolonization, so many of these projects, you know, have failed to produce the end, but that doesn't mean that we can afford to stop imagining what the end might look like.
Actually, Saidiya just brought the conversation to a close. No, we are actually running out of time now, and I just want to acknowledge your comment and thank you for what you said. Also, thank you, because there are others of us in this audience who have been committed to and part of creating archives, part of creating those other spaces. And it is important for us to acknowledge that. I wanted to acknowledge the little boy who was here. He just left. He looked like about five. but you raise an important question.
question about what it might mean. How might we give visibility to those kinds of archetypes without taking them over, without fitting them in the structure of our way of knowing and thinking? And I will close now, not in summary, but just one thing that interests me, and it's because I've been working with many people here who are a part of activist projects. A part of my investment, I will say, in the question of hope is because I think of activism as hope. It is what I think of as a radical impatience with the status quo and an idea that they are committed to that moment when it can all be demolished, but also to what comes after that point, that other future. I want to say that a hope that is not hopeful, but not hopeless, that pessimism might invite us to imagine the promise of future worlds. I was very interested in the idea that archives might offer the great diversity of Black radical projects that we sometimes and oftentimes and almost always leave unnoticed. That in them are also those moments of adjacency that are necessary for us to see things otherwise. And if anything else, the project at least that we want to formulate and why we have invited you and invite you to participate in is exactly that project of imagining what it is to be otherwise, imagining the otherwise together. And that is a commitment that I think you share, and I hope we all share. Thank you all for coming. For traveling all this way to come here and be with us. Look out, we will have more of these kinds of conversations. Thank you. CMC staff who all worked hard to make this happen, and especially to Juliet, who's somewhere in the room. I need to big her up, shout her out. All right, thank you.